Many people have been asking for a first-person controller for O3DE for quite some time now, or even just a first-person tutorial to help someone get started. Since O3DE is still a relatively new game engine, the developers are focused on improving core features of the engine. So, due to the lack of an existing first-person controller gem, we decided we didn't want to wait around for someone else to make it, so we made one ourselves. And in this video, I'll be walking you through our first-person controller gem in O3DE. It's a fully featured controller that includes all the basic things you'd expect, such as walking, jumping, sprinting, and crouching. We really wanted to get this first-person controller right, unlike some controllers in other engines. So we also added a ton of other super cool advanced features that let you tweak the physics of your character's movement so you can achieve a unique feel that's specific to your game. And to top it off, this gem is completely free to use and open source. To get set up, I'll show you how to download and install this gem, how to enable it inside your project, how to properly set up your project's level and components, and I'll go over each parameter and describe what each one does, so you can have the confidence to create a completely unique first-person experience for your game. So if you're not familiar with O3DE yet, you may be asking yourself, what the heck is a gem? Well, gems basically act as modules or packages that contain code or assets that provide a specific functionality to the engine. O3DE was built to be modular, so most of the engine is made up of these modules called gems. This includes gems for things like the renderer, physics, visual scripting, audio, and a bunch of other things, which are all included in the default project template. The first-person controller gem is a third-party gem that we created, and it doesn't come included with the game engine, so you'll need to download and enable it for your project. It's also important that I mention that this gem does not include a project, a level, scripts, or any other assets. It only provides a first-person controller that you can use in your own project. Now, let's talk about how to actually get the gem. The gem is hosted on GitHub, and you can find the repository linked in the description. Copy the URL, because you'll need it in a second. The easiest way to add the gem to your project is through O3DE's Project Manager. To do that, click the Gems tab at the top of the Project Manager page. Then go over to the top right corner and click this hamburger menu icon. Then select Show Gem Repos and click the Add Repository button. Here is where you'll paste the GitHub link we copied earlier. Then click the Add button. After adding the first person controller gem to the project manager, we need to create a project to actually use the gem. If this is your first time creating a project, click this Create a Project button. Otherwise, click this blue New Project button and select Create New Project. Here you can name the project whatever you'd like. I'm going to name it First Person Project. Then you choose your preferred project directory. On the right side of this page is where you can enable additional gems to your project. Click this button. You'll see a new page with a list of a bunch of gems in O3DE. Let's do a search for the First Person Controller gem. Then you need to toggle this on to enable the gem. Click Create Project after the gem has been enabled. You might see a pop-up warning telling you that the gem requires the physics and starting point input gems. This is okay because the default project template comes with these gems already included. Click Continue, and then you'll get a new message saying that your project likely needs to be rebuilt. Click OK, and let's build our new project. If you already have a project created and just want to enable the first-person controller gem for it, just click the menu icon underneath your project and select Configure Gems. After that, you can follow the same steps I did earlier when I enabled the gem in a new project. It's important to remember that when you enable or disable a gem in O3DE, or if you are creating a project for the first time, you'll need to build your project. Luckily though, it's pretty easy with the Project Manager. Just click this Build Project button and select Build Now, then select Yes. After the project finishes building, click Open Editor. The asset processor may take a while if this is a new project. Wait for that to finish. Now we need to create a new level. Click the Create New button, and let's call our level First Person Level. I'll go ahead and leave the default location, and then click OK. Now we're finally ready to start setting up our first person game. Once your level finishes loading and are inside the editor, the first thing we want to do is create an entity for our character. Right-click the Entity Outliner and select Create Entity. This entity will be our player character. Let's rename it to Cylinder Dude. You'll see why in a moment. Next, let's add a component, and search for the First Person Controller component. You'll notice that when you first add it, you'll get a warning telling you that you're missing some required components. To add these, let's click Add Required Component and select PhysX Character Controller Component. Then do the same thing for the input component. We'll need to set up both of these components before we can start moving around and playing with our character. First, let's go to the PhysX Character Controller. This component is going to give our character a collider with a few other physics-related features. For the collider shape, keep this as capsule, or else the first-person controller won't work properly. And then let's change the size of the capsule collider to something more common in games. So let's enter 1.8 meters for the height and 0.3 meters for the radius. We'll come back to the input and first-person controller components in a bit. Now, it'd be nice to actually see our character while we're working in the editor. So let's add a 3D model. Before we do that though, let's delete this shader ball because we won't need it for this tutorial. Now, go over to the cylinder dude entity in the entity outliner, right-click it, and then select Create Entity. This will create a child entity. Let's rename this to Cylinder Shape. Now we want to find a 3D model to represent our character. So let's add a mesh. Search for mesh and add a mesh component. In the model asset field, click the folder icon and search for cylinder. Or navigate down through the gems folder, then primitive assets, assets, objects, primitive, and then select the cylinder 1x1 FBX file. Now let's resize the cylinder to look closer to a character. In the transform component, click add non-uniform scale, and then let's change the scale to 0.6 for X, 0.6 for Y, and 1.8 for Z. Now we don't want our cylinder dude to be halfway underground. So let's go up to the transform component and next to translate, type in 0.9 for Z. Next, let's give our cylinder a color that stands out. Select add material component. This will create a new material component. Here under model materials, you want to click this little arrow icon and select edit material instance. This opens up the material property inspector, where you can add and edit a bunch of different types of textures and materials. For this tutorial, we just want to change the color of the cylinder. So to do that, you go to base color and click this gray color icon and select whichever color you prefer. I like green, so I'm going to enter in these RGB values that I already picked out. Now we can close this window. Now that we have a visual representation for our cylinder dude, we need to add a camera so we can actually look around in first person. Your project should already come with a camera by default. We want to make it a child of our cylinder dude so it moves around with the character. To do that, just click and drag it on top of the cylinder dude entity. Then inside the camera entity, make sure to delete the fly camera input component because we won't need it. If you don't already have a camera entity in your project and need to create one, just right-click the cylinder dude entity and select Create Entity. Rename this entity to Camera, and then add a camera component. Now we want to move the camera to the correct spot on our character so we can actually see in the first-person perspective. Right-click the transform component and select Reset Transform Values. Then move the camera up on the Z-axis at around eye level. We also want to keep it inside the cylinder so it's not visible to the camera. Now we're almost ready to start moving around in first person. If you enter game mode by pressing Ctrl and G, you'll notice that we can see in first person, but we can't move yet. To start moving, we'll need to set up the input bindings so we can actually control our character with an input device, like a keyboard and mouse or gamepad. Exit game mode by pressing the escape key. Then go back to the cylinder dude entity and over to the first person controller component. Click the down arrow icon next to input bindings. You'll notice that this will show all the input binding names for our character. In order to start moving, we'll need to map these out to our input event names. To do that, we'll need to go over to the asset editor. If you don't see it, go over to Tools and click Asset Editor. Click File, New, and Input Bindings. Click this plus icon in the input event groups. Let's start with the forward movement key. Here, you want to enter the same name we have for the forward key in the first person controller component. By default, this is just forward, so I'll just type that in here. This can be any name, you just have to make sure it matches the corresponding input binding field in the first person controller component. Next, you want to click the plus icon here next to the event generators. A small window will pop up here. Click the drop-down menu and select Input Event Map. Now click this little arrow icon here next to Select Input. And then click this drop-down menu next to Input Device. I'm going to select Keyboard since that's what I'll be using for my forward key. Then next to the input name is where we'll select the actual key we want for the forward movement. In the drop-down menu, scroll down until you find Keyboard Key Alphanumeric W. Now our forward movement should be set up and ready. Let's save this input binding file by going to File, Save As, and I'm going to save this in the Assets folder and call it First Person Input. Then save the project. Now if we go back to our Cylinder Dude entity and go to the input component, we can assign our new input binding by clicking this icon and navigating to the first person input file we just created. Now if we go into play mode again with Ctrl G, we can move forward with the W key. But there's a problem. Our movement is a little jittery. Luckily though, there's an easy fix. If you go over to the PhysX configuration menu in the top left corner of the editor, and if you don't see it, go to Tools and select PhysX configuration. Under this global configuration tab, you want to set this fixed time step to whatever your ideal frame time is. By default, it's set to about 0.0167 seconds, which is the frame time for 60 frames per second. It's worth mentioning that by default, O3DE uses your monitor's refresh rate to determine the frame rate you'll get. So if you have a 60 Hz refresh rate, you're likely to be capped at 60 frames per second, in which case you can just keep it at this number. However, if you have higher frame rates like 120 frames per second or a 120 Hz monitor, you want to make this a little smaller. In this case, we have a frame time of 1 divided by 120, which is 0.0083333 seconds. Now, if we save the project and go into play mode, we'll notice that the movement is much smoother now. Let's set up our camera mouse movement next, so we can look around in first person. Go back to the asset editor and click the plus icon next to Input Event Groups. Let's name this Yaw. Click the plus icon next to Event Generators, and then select Input Event Map in this window. Click this arrow next to Select Input. Now under Input Device, select Mouse. And under Input Name, navigate to Mouse Delta X and select it. Now, let's save this input binding, or else we won't notice any changes when we go back into play mode. Then save the project. Now, if we enter play mode, we can move forward and move our character left and right with our mouse. I'm going to skip ahead for the rest of the input bindings, but feel free to pause and copy these settings. Make sure to save your input bindings in the asset editor and save your project once you're finished. Now, with all the input bindings set up, if you enter play mode, you can move and look around in a fully functional first-person perspective. You can also jump, sprint, and crouch. So that's really cool, but what if you want to customize your character's controls and change things, like the camera sensitivity, speed, or the jump height? Well, I'll show you how to do all of that and more. Let's start with the camera settings. Let's go back to our Cylinder Dude entity and go over to the first-person controller component. Click the arrow next to Camera Rotation to expand the camera-related parameters. Here is where you can edit all the camera-related settings. The yaw sensitivity controls your horizontal sensitivity, and pitch sensitivity controls the camera's vertical sensitivity. Larger numbers will give you more sensitivity, and smaller numbers will give you less. If you want to invert your camera rotation, just make these numbers negative. The camera rotation damp factor controls how much smoothness you get out of the camera rotation. Decrease this number for a smoother, more delayed camera rotation, and increase it for a quicker and snappier rotation. The camera slurp instead of lerp rotation toggle just chooses whether you use linear interpolation or spherical linear interpolation for the camera smoothing. There isn't a huge difference between the two. Just choose whichever you prefer. The next section, Direction Scale Factors, sets the base movement scale for each direction, and applies to both walking and sprinting. These numbers act as multipliers for the speed in the given directions. Forward, left, and right are set to 1 by default, while back is set to 0.75. So in this case, the backward movement will be a little slower. Specifically, you will only get up to 75% of the top speed when traveling backwards. The next section, X and Y Movement, focuses on walking movement. Top walking speed determines your maximum walking speed. Since we're using 5 meters per second by default, if you used 1 for your forward movement scale, you would walk at a maximum of 5 meters per second in the forward direction. And since the back scale was set to 0.75, you'll be moving at 5 times 0.75, which equals 3.75 meters per second when moving backwards. The walking acceleration determines how long it takes for your character to reach a target velocity. So if we were to exaggerate this and set it to 5, you'll notice that it takes a full second to get up to our top walking speed, which is what we should expect because 5 meters per second divided by 5 meters per second squared is 1 second. The deceleration factor determines how long it takes for you to stop moving. This number acts as a factor that is multiplied with the walking acceleration to determine your deceleration. If you set this to 1, your deceleration will be the same as your acceleration, which in this case is 5 meters per second squared. I personally like the deceleration to be a little faster than the acceleration, so I'll keep mine at the default value of 1.5. The opposing direction deceleration is a little different than the regular deceleration. It determines how quickly you brake when changing directions. You'll notice this mostly when you strafe in opposing directions. So you can use this to have your character stop faster when switching directions. This option, add velocity for physics time step instead of tick, makes it so our character's velocity is added every physics time step, which is the time interval in between physics simulation steps, or per tick, which is every frame. From our testing, applying velocity per physics time step produces the most repeatable jumps and movement, even with lag frames. X and Y movement tracks surface inclines tilts your character's X and Y movement to follow slopes or inclines. Turning this on will prevent your character from bouncing while going down a slope, which is a common issue in many character controllers. This will only apply to the max angle entered in the PhysX character controller component. The PhysX character controller also determines what happens when the slope of an incline is greater than this max number. By default, it's set to prevent climbing, but we suggest using this option for sliding. Instant velocity rotation is one of my favorite parameters. Leaving this on will let your character rotate instantly, but turning this off is when it gets interesting. Acceleration and deceleration will be applied when rotating your character, which is closer to what you'd expect in real-world physics, and will give a real sense of weight to your character. Now let's talk about sprinting. The sprint forward, back, left, and right scales are similar to the direction scale factors, but they specifically apply to sprinting. A value of 1.5 for the sprint forward scale means that you'll sprint at 1.5 times your walking speed in the forward direction. Having 1 for the sprint back scale means that you'll sprint backward at 1 times your walking speed, which actually means there won't be any sprint applied when moving only backwards. Sprint left and right scales are set to 1.25 times the walk speed, so a little less than the forward sprint. And if you move in the diagonal directions or are using a gamepad, the sprint will gradually scale in between these values. The sprint acceleration scale determines how fast you reach your desired velocity while sprinting. This number multiplies with your walking acceleration. So in this case, my sprint acceleration will be 1.5 times 5, equaling 7.5 meters per second squared, which is 50% greater than the walking acceleration. The sprint max time is part of the stamina and cooldown system. It determines how long you can continuously sprint before you initiate the cooldown time. We set this to a default of 120 seconds, so you might not notice it. You can set this to a lower number based on your game's requirements. After sprinting long enough such that the sprint max time is reached, the sprint cooldown time determines how long you'll have to wait before you can sprint again. This sprint backwards toggle determines if you want to apply the sprint factor when you have a backwards component to your character's movement. Disabling this will completely prevent you from sprinting while moving back, even if there's just a slight backwards component to your movement. The sprint while crouched toggle just determines if you want your character to be able to sprint while crouched, which leads us into the crouching section. The crouched speed scale determines your movement speed while crouched. This is set to 0.5 by default, which means your walking speed will be cut in half while crouching. The crouch distance is how far your camera will move down on the Z-axis when crouching. Your PhysX character controller collider will also automatically compress down in its height by the same amount, which will allow you to move underneath obstacles with lower clearances. The crouch time determines how quickly you want the crouch to happen. The crouch standing head clearance is the distance above the character's head that determines if the character can stand up or not. If an object gets within this distance of the character's head, then the motion of standing up stops, preventing the character from clipping through the object above them. Crouch enable toggle determines if the crouch key toggles crouching when the key is pressed. If disabled, you have to keep the crouch key held to stay crouched. Crouch jump causes standing makes it so pressing the jump key will force you to stand up, and if you continue holding the jump key long enough, you will perform the jump. Crouch sprint causes standing is similar in that pressing the sprint key will also cause you to stand up if this is enabled. Having this enabled effectively overrides the sprint while crouched, if you have that enabled as well. Crouch priority when sprint pressed just means that if you're sprinting and press the crouch key, you'll enter the crouch state. If you turn this off, you won't be able to crouch while the sprint key is pressed. Now to the fun part, the jumping section. The grounded collision group lets you decide which surfaces you want to be counted as ground. We recommend keeping this on all when starting out. The first person controller gem uses a sphere cast that moves down on the Z-axis to check if you're grounded. This prevents you from being able to jump while you're in the air, unless you have double jump enabled, as well as to prevent your character from accumulating velocity on Z while standing on something. The jump head hit collision group determines the collision group that's checked when you hit an obstacle above your head. I'll talk more about head hit collisions in a little bit. Gravity is the downward force acting on the character on the Z-axis, but only when you're not grounded. So if you jump or walk off a ledge or platform, you'll be affected by gravity. If you want a slower or floatier jump, you can increase this to something more realistic, like negative 9.81. And conversely, you can decrease this to make your jump snappier. The initial jump velocity determines how much velocity is applied to the character at the beginning of your jump, when you first press the jump key. The higher this number is, the higher the character will go. The second jump initial velocity is the same thing, but only applies to your second jump. This will only be applied if you have Enable Double Jump turned on. The jump held gravity factor and the jump falling gravity factor are where you can really start tweaking the feel of your jump. These are factors that are multiplied against whatever you entered for the gravity field. The jump held gravity factor determines how much gravity you want at the beginning of your jump while holding the jump key. The jump falling gravity factor determines how much gravity you want while falling. So if you want a faster fall that's more common in 2D platform games, you would increase this number. X and Y acceleration jump factor determines how much you're able to change the character's movement on X or Y while in the air. If this number is close to zero, then you won't be able to adjust your character's movement on X or Y while in the air. If this number is one, then you'll be able to move on X and Y just like you would on the ground. The ground sphere-cast's radius percentage increase lets you increase the size of your ground check. At 0%, the ground detection sphere-cast has the same radius as the PhysX capsule collider of the character. However, this lets you increase it further. Usually this makes sense if you want to provide some extra space on ledges before falling down. We've set the default to 41.5% based on extensive testing. Grounded offset effectively sets the distance between the bottom of the character and the ground. You can really notice what this does if you make it large. Ground close offset is an arbitrary distance that you would choose that checks when you're getting close to the ground. This parameter is used in the update X and Y velocity when ground close option, but can also be very useful for scripting. One example of using this parameter could be to implement a screen shake when you're about to hit the ground. The jump hold distance parameter is really powerful and gives you the ability to have variable jump heights. You can use this to change the height of your jump, depending on how long you hold the jump key. A bigger number here gives you more jump height variability. By doing this, you can hold down the jump key longer, allowing your character to jump higher. During this initial jump hold distance, the jump held gravity factor is being applied. It's possible to enter a number that's bigger than can actually be used, such that it exceeds the apogee or the maximum height of the jump. You'll see a warning in the console if this happens. The jump head hit detection distance lets you choose the distance between the top of the character and an obstacle or ceiling, which will prevent you from jumping higher. The bigger this number is, the further away you would detect an object above your head, which would stop the jump sooner. The jump head hit set's apogee toggle makes you fully stop if you jump up and collide with an obstacle, abruptly shortening your character's jump. If this is disabled, you can potentially still slide upward along an inclined obstacle after you jump up and collide with it. The jump head hit ignore non-kinematic rigid bodies toggle, when enabled, will ignore non-kinematic rigid body objects when jumping and colliding with them, and won't prevent you from continuing your jump. If this is disabled and you try to jump up and collide with a non-kinematic rigid body entity, your character will stop there and be prevented from going higher. The enable double jump toggle lets you jump a second time in the air. To adjust the velocity of your second jump, you want to change the second jump initial velocity parameter. The update X and Y velocity when ascending and descending fields let you change your character's direction while they're in the air, when ascending or descending. And the last parameter, update X and Y velocity only when ground close toggle, only allows you to adjust movement on X and Y when you're close to the ground, which is determined by the ground close offset parameter we went over earlier. And that's it for all the first person controller parameters. Even with everything I've gone through in this video, there's a whole nother level to this gem I haven't even covered. It comes with a plethora of script canvas nodes that you can use to customize your game's experience even more. If you'd like to dig deeper and learn more about how everything works, you can take a look at the source code found in the Git repository, which is linked in the description. Also, we welcome you to submit pull requests to improve this gem. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask in the comments section or the O3DE Discord server, and we'll do our best to answer them.